As we've seen in the first two programs, by the end of the 18th century, atheism had finally emerged in France. But it was more or less confined to the educated and the privileged. There was as yet no open expression of plebeian doubt. And yet over the next 200 years, atheism would begin to infiltrate the lives of ordinary people, and the once obedient piety of the working class would undergo a radical transformation. So how did that happen? In 1790, the Parisian aristocrat Paul Henri Thierry, the Baron d'Holbach, wrote a book that was so openly atheistic and so provocative that the French authorities, not content with banning it, had it publicly burned by the official executioner.
It is only by dispelling the clouds and phantoms of religion that we shall discover truth, reason, and morality.
The Baron d'Holbach is widely referred to as the Newton of the atheists. His book, The System of Nature, is often accepted as the first openly and avowedly atheist work in European scholarship. And yet, he wasn't quite as bold as that suggests. After all, the book was published under an assumed name. Atheism, it seems, even when it finally emerged, was not yet quite a safe idea. In England, the intellectual elite didn't even go as far as that. They weren't atheists exactly, but deists. That's to say, they didn't deny the existence of God. They were perfectly happy to reconstruct Christianity and reduce the deity to some distant first cause. And to be on the safe side, what the intellectual aristocrats did was not to talk about it in front of the servants. Religion was far too intricately bound up with the fabric of political authority and social hierarchy. Indeed, it was an essential ingredient in the maintenance of the privileged life which the elite themselves enjoyed. To undermine the religious faith of the masses would be both politically dangerous and perhaps socially suicidal. And yet, this could not, and indeed, it didn't last. By the end of the 18th century, a more popular, and some would say more subversive form of skepticism began to appear. And although, to begin with, it didn't take the form of explicit atheism, the argumentative deism of lower middle class publicists such as Thomas Paine set the stage for a much more radical form of religious skepticism. One which, in England at least, was to find itself in almost unremitting conflict with the political and legal establishment.
Of all the tyrannies that afflict mankind, tyranny in religion is the worst. Every other species of tyranny is limited to the world we live in, but this attempts a stride beyond the grave and seeks to pursue us into eternity.
It's no exaggeration to say that Thomas Paine was one of the most influential thinkers that England has ever produced. But his skeptical attitude, his deism, was profoundly different from that of the privileged classes in which deism had originally been born. He was a self-taught philosopher who had not benefited from a university education. The revolutionary impact of his ideas has been studied by the Cambridge historian Simon Schaffer.
What I think is so striking is that a lot of the relatively elite intellectual response to the appearance of plebeian unbelief in cheap print is not so much that these are false arguments, but that they're dangerous arguments. Since it's agreed on all hands that knowledge is power, giving power and giving the power of materialism and naturalism to large sectors of the labouring classes was judged to be very dangerous. And one does see in the 1820s in England, for example, folk who are, as it were, elite atheists, who argue that there is no rational evidence for the existence of God, that you don't have to ground morality on faith in God's existence, but that it would be socially fatal for everybody to know that. There's a sense in which there's always been a social heft to the debate about atheism in Britain. That there are ideas it's safe to contemplate, but not safe to publish and make widely available.
All churches, whether Jewish, Christian or Muslim, appear to me no other than human inventions set up to terrify and enslave mankind and to monopolize power and profit.
It's not altogether surprising that the first and most enthusiastic people to embrace Tom Paine were the dissatisfied colonists in North America. Paine's eloquent advocacy of independence proved to be inspirational, and it was he who first coined the phrase that dignified their revolutionary ambitions, the United States of America. Paine abandoned his English home and went to live in America. And the first rare editions of some of his most influential early works can be found in this New England museum.
It's interesting when you look at this first edition of Common Sense, which, as you see on the title page, is addressed to the inhabitants of America. Even in the first paragraphs, when he's addressing himself to the problems of society, there are already expressions of the principles which stimulate him to criticize the authority of the church. Society in every state is a blessing, but government, even in its best state, is but a necessary evil. Now, that distinction really applies to what he later says in The Age of Reason about the authority of the church. Almost everywhere in The Age of Reason, he attacks orthodox beliefs and encourages people to develop their own rationality, their own moral sensibilities, and their natural ability to interact morally with one another, contrary to what the monarchical and indeed the ecclesiastical authorities thought, that without the church, without government, man would become wicked and return to his animal nature.
It is from the Bible that man has learned cruelty, rapine and murder. For the belief in a cruel God makes a cruel man. And the Bible is a history of wickedness that has served to corrupt and brutalize mankind.
Here he was, what the upper classes would have called a common man. But he's expressing what all men have in common, which is much more interesting.
The most detestable wickedness, the most horrid cruelties, and the greatest miseries that have afflicted the human race have had their origin in this thing called religion.
As soon as the Americans had succeeded in establishing their independence, they were eager to show their gratitude to the English radical who had helped to inspire them.
In 1776, the estate on which the original house over there once stood was commandeered by the state of New York and taken from someone who had been a loyalist to the British during the War of Independence. And in 1784, it was given to Thomas Paine in recognition of his services to the American Revolution.
Tom Paine did not immediately take up residence in this house. For not content with inspiring the American Revolution and helping to write the Declaration of Independence, he was also influencing the revolutionary thinkers in France, who would soon tear down that country's monarchy. Paine left the United States and traveled to Paris. He was welcomed and, extraordinarily, elected to the Revolutionary National Assembly. The French revolutionaries closed down churches across the whole country, and the Bishop of Paris was forced to declare himself a charlatan. And yet the revolution was not, strictly speaking, atheist. Robespierre, for example, insisted on the existence of some kind of supreme being. A fete or festival was dedicated to this supreme being. But it's questionable how seriously this was taken when you hear stories that it was a Paris prostitute who was crowned the goddess of reason here in the deconsecrated church now called the Pantheon. Paine may have supported the revolution, but since he was opposed to the execution of the French king, he was imprisoned and only narrowly escaped the guillotine. And there was no welcome for such a skeptical revolutionary in England. So he returned to America, to the farm he'd been given by that grateful nation. Ironically, his religious skepticism was now something of an embarrassment to many Americans, and he died unmourned and more or less ignored in New York in 1809. When you stand here alongside the busy traffic in this dauntingly affluent suburb of New York City, it's quite difficult to believe that this modest bronze tablet marks what was once the burial ground of one of the emblematic heroes of the American Revolution. Less than 2 years after Paine's death, the English radical William Cobbett exhumed his body and took it back to England. But the British government refused to build a memorial to Tom Paine, and unbelievably, at some point, the body was simply lost.
Thomas Paine needs no monument made of hands. He has erected a monument in the hearts of all lovers of liberty.
Tom Paine has no tomb. His body lies somewhere in an unmarked grave. Given the impact of Paine's ideas in America and France, it's hardly surprising that radical deism and atheism gained a dangerous reputation. In England, Paine was now known amongst a growing number of political radicals as the immortal Tom Paine. His book, The Rights of Man, had been published in pamphlet form for the readership of the masses, and by the time of his death, 1,500,000 copies had been sold. His rhetoric had helped to inspire revolutions in America and France, so the English authorities were doubly on their guard. Paine's skeptical and radical ideas were now taking hold in England, where still only 3% of the population had the right to vote. In August 1819, more than 50,000 ordinary men and women came here to St. Peter's Square in Manchester. They came to hear speeches calling for parliamentary reform, and in response, the authorities sent in the cavalry with sabres. In the process, 11 people were killed and over 400 injured. This, the Peterloo Massacre revealed the extent to which the English authorities were prepared to go to defend a status quo that itself depended upon the support of a Christian establishment. On that day, one of the speakers, a witness to the massacre, was the atheist Richard Carlyle. Carlyle had already come into conflict with the establishment by publishing and distributing Tom Paine's pamphlets. The fact is that Richard Carlyle would be one of an apostolic succession of atheist radicals committed to the interests of the working class, who would, over the next 100 years, help to create a new political philosophy. However, the government realized that radicalism and atheism went hand in hand, and they were determined to fight them both. Richard Carlyle was actually imprisoned for publishing an atheistic and politically subversive journal called The Republican. His crime? Blasphemous and seditious libel. His journal carried on under the editorship of his wife, but she was also imprisoned. And then his sister, but she was also imprisoned. Indeed, 150 people were imprisoned for publishing and selling The Republican, and between them they served a total of 200 years in jail. In fact, one of the Republican's most distinguished contributors was the romantic poet Percy Bysshe Shelley, who had been sent down from Oxford for writing a pamphlet called The Necessity of Atheism.
If he is infinitely good, what reason should we have to fear him? If he is infinitely wise, why should we have doubts concerning our future? If he knows all, why warn him of our needs and fatigue him with our prayers? If he is everywhere, why erect temples to him?
Oxford University was unfortunately not prepared to see Shelley's work as a promising philosophical treatise. Perhaps he was born just a fraction too early to be able to attend a university where his opinions might not have been so out of place. He could have gone, as I did, to University College in London.
I don't know exactly why I chose to come here to University College Hospital to do my clinical work after I graduated in natural sciences at Cambridge in 1956. I think that one of the reasons was the fact that the medical school was associated with a university on the other side of the road, and that meant that I could follow up some of the things that had interested me as a student at Cambridge. But I was also drawn by the fact that it was a secular institution. In fact, the place was known almost from its foundation as the Godless Institution of Gower Street. And that was because when this college was established in 1826, it was deliberately created in order to allow students of all religious denominations, and perhaps none, to study and graduate.
Until the initiative that founded University College London, it was impossible to enter any British university if you were not a communicating member of the Church of England. This, of course, excluded Catholics, Jews, non-conformists, and, of course, non-believers.
What you see in this box are the mortal remains of someone who was perhaps the most memorable person responsible for this philanthropic initiative. It is, of course, the utilitarian philosopher Jeremy Bentham, who on his death strangely insisted that his medical colleagues publicly dissected his body. In fact, although the head of this effigy is just a waxwork now, the original head is kept in deep freeze elsewhere, the founder's bones still exist under the clothes that you can see here. Now, the fact that someone other than an executed criminal would voluntarily submit his corpse for public dissection indicates Bentham's sublime indifference to the notion of resurrection, his disbelief in immortality, and his commitment to the utterly material basis of reality.
Nevertheless, Bentham did recognize the need for some sort of secular alternative that would guarantee the moral stability of society. And for him, the answer was utilitarianism, the greatest happiness of the greatest number. Now, eloquent though his arguments were, it was difficult to see in it a practical program of social action of the sort that political radicals like Carlyle were looking for. And when philosophical principles were eventually recruited to the service of social reform, they took a much more subversive and revolutionary turn, which would dominate the political agenda of the whole world for the next 100 years. The very idea of a secular moral philosophy, not to mention a social order based on it, was inevitably in conflict with a Christian establishment. At the same time, Christians were about to be disconcerted by a completely unexpected threat to the foundations of their belief. Although it took some time for the church to reconcile itself to the picture of the universe which Copernicus and Galileo had created. And incidentally, Galileo was not officially apologized to until 1984. But by the end of the 18th century, the spatial layout of the universe was now an established fact. But when it came to chronological considerations, science was about to embarrass Christian dogma once again. Wherever the Earth was said to be situated in the universe, the religious belief was that it was created by God as described in Genesis, in 6 days. And this idea was still at the foundation of Christian and Jewish faith. The fact is that there were academics and theologians who had spent hours calculating what they thought was the precise age of the Earth on the basis of the biblical account of it. And as early as 1650, James Usher had come to the startlingly precise conclusion that the Earth was created in 4004 BC on October the 22nd, in the evening apparently. What God had been doing that morning is still open to conjecture. But the rapidly developing science of geology in the hands of men such as Buckland, Hutton, and above all Charles Lyell was about to subvert the idea that the Earth was created as recently as theologians had previously maintained. According to the newly emerging version of geological history, the Earth had existed for many millions of years. And this was one of the basic presuppositions upon which Charles Darwin would eventually raise the theory of evolution.
There's a strange sense of paradox as you walk around this rather impressive estate and realize that this was the house in which The Origin of Species was written by a wealthy person from the British upper middle class establishment. Charles Darwin, after all, was a gentleman with unquestionable social pedigree, and yet his book was one which would subvert the foundations, the intellectual foundations upon which a great deal of English social life was based.
The point is that Darwin's work would call into question God's role as the creator of nature. and that would inevitably undermine the authority of a predominantly Christian social and political establishment.
And what he finally published in 1859 would turn the theological establishment, and to some extent, by the same token, the social establishment, on its head.
By formulating a theory that explained the origin of species, Darwin was inevitably challenging the idea that God himself was the origin of everything. It was a devastating, and as the American philosopher Daniel Dennett has pointed out, a dangerous idea.
At the beginning of your book, you refer to this wonderful schoolboy notion of a universal acid, yeah, which no receptacle can contain. And you make a comparison with that and Darwinian theory. Now, I wonder if you'd like to explain in what respect Darwin's idea was dangerous.
Well, I think that we've had an idea, humankind has had an idea, for as long as there have been people, and that is, it takes a big fancy thing to make a simpler thing. Mm-hmm. You never see a horseshoe making a blacksmith. Mm-hmm. You never see a pot making a potter. It's always the other way around, big fancy things making simpler things. And then along came Darwin, and he had the audacity to propose a complete inversion of that idea. That the purport of Darwin's theory was, in order to make a perfect and beautiful machine, it is not requisite to know how to make it. And it was this inversion of reasoning that was so dangerous, because it turned everything upside down in a way. It suggested that we could have a bottom-up theory of creative genius rather than a top-down, rather than a trickle-down theory, which depended on an intelligent artificer. The basic idea is so simple that you have variation, that inevitably, if there's variation in the population, some are going to be better than others, and the ones that are better than others are going to have more kids than the ones, than the less favored ones, and the offspring are going to resemble their parents. And most of the skepticism over the century plus that we've had since Darwin proposed this idea has been along the lines of, well, there's just too much work to be done by such a simple process.
But the newly discovered billions of years in the Earth's history gave plenty of time for Darwin's slow evolutionary process to work. And believers in God simply had to accept that they might have a problem. Darwin's discovery of natural selection is the first time that a scientific idea subverts one of the principal arguments in favor of God, because it dispenses with the idea of design. Well, his theory has a certain sort of elegance, because wherever you observe life, although its efficiency is undoubtedly startling, the developments are sort of gimcrack. They're improvised. They're put together without a view to an outcome. In fact, when you come to think of it, the word improvise is rather unfortunate and misleading, because it makes it look as if something is blundering its way towards a conclusion, whereas nothing is blundering its way towards anything. There's no mentality at work here. There's no conscious object in view. The process, for example, of getting bits and pieces of the jaw of ancient reptiles into the inner ear of modern mammals, bones which enable them to hear, is not one that took place because something foresaw that those bones might come in handy as a hearing device. Hearing simply emerged as an unintended consequence of the unsolicited variations.
In Darwin's time, the material basis of heredity was still obscure, and the origin of the variations or novelties upon which natural selection worked remained utterly mysterious. The biologist Richard Dawkins has written at great length about genetics and has committed much of his academic career to answering the questions that arise from Darwin's theory. Something has to explain the novelties themselves.
Yeah. Well, the novelties themselves, of course, are genetic variations in the gene pool, which ultimately come from mutation and more proximately come from sexual recombination. There's nothing very inventive or ingenious about those novelties. I mean, they are random. Mm. And they mostly are deleterious. Most mutations are bad. And so you really need to focus on natural selection as the positive side. And it's only natural selection that produces living things which have the illusion of design. The illusion of design does not come from the novelty.
What was it about that early novelty, before it culminated in something as useful as a feather? Where could natural selection get its purchase upon something which was no more than a pimple?
There cannot have been intermediate stages which were not beneficial. There's no room in natural selection for the sort of foresight argument that says, well, if we go persist for the next million years and it'll start becoming useful. That doesn't work. There's got to be a selection pressure all the way.
So there isn't a process, as it were, going on in the cell saying, look, be patient.
No.
It's going to be a feather, believe me.
Yes. It doesn't happen like that. There's got to be a series of advantages all the way in the feather. If you can't think of one, then that's your problem, not natural selection's problem. Natural selection, well, I suppose that is a sort of matter of faith on my part, since the theory is so coherent and so powerful.
Richard Dawkins' faith in natural selection is bolstered by the fact that, as Darwin noticed, the painful details hardly support the idea of a benevolent designer.
I cannot persuade myself that a beneficent and omnipotent God would have created the ichneumonidae with the express intention of their feeding within the living bodies of caterpillars, or that God would have designedly created that a cat should play with mice.
Darwin's own religious faith had slowly ebbed away over the years, but that was due as much to the death of his daughter as to his scientific ideas. But for a variety of reasons, not least of which was the fact that his wife was still deeply religious, and he himself, of course, realized the theological implications of his own theory, Darwin resisted publication of his work for almost 20 years. It was only when another younger man, Alfred Russel Wallace, submitted a work with almost exactly the same scientific conclusions that Darwin was pushed into publication. And as he feared, the reaction was dramatic.
Is it on his grandmother's or his grandfather's side that he claims descent from a monkey? There is a metaphysical part of nature. A man who denies this may sink the human race into a lower grade of degradation than any into which it has fallen since written records began.
For understandable reasons, the established church was appalled by the theory of evolution because it denied the very idea of an inaugural creation in which all natural forms had been established from the outset. And as far as the clergy were concerned, what was even more shocking was the idea that man was included in this process, and that as a mere descendant of apes, he had lost his curious spiritual priority.
Man was no longer the star of this cosmic event.
When you consider the relative ease with which educated Christians, as we've already seen, had been able to reconcile their beliefs with some of the new astronomical discoveries, it's not altogether surprising that, with the exception of ignorant and stupid fundamentalists for whom Darwinism is a blasphemy, there were, and still are, religious people willing and able to accommodate the now undeniable Darwinian proposals. But the point is that the religious now had to visualize the architecture of living things in an altogether new way. One in which God could no longer be represented as an ever-present, pedantic designer. But while the religious view of God was growing more attenuated, those who took a skeptical and radical view were feeling more and more confident. The leadership of the sceptical and radical reformers was now undertaken by George Jacob Holyoake, and in his journal, The Reasoner, he coined a new word to describe a belief system based upon reason and science. He called it secularism. Well, by the middle of the 19th century, there were more than 40 secular societies in Britain, and Holyoake's journal was selling more than 5,000 copies a week. Secularism was hugely popular throughout the 19th century, and the National Secular Society still exists in the 21st century here in Conway Hall in London. After Holyoake, the leadership of the secular societies fell to Charles Bradlaugh, a radical MP famous for being expelled from Parliament and briefly locked in the Tower of London for his failure as an atheist to swear on the Bible his oath of allegiance. Bradlaugh secured the right, which we still enjoy, for every man and woman in this country to affirm an oath rather than having to swear on the Bible. At the turn of the century, one might have been forgiven for thinking that disbelief would soon triumph, that religion would soon fade away and die. Nietzsche had just said, amongst many other things, that God was dead. So why should faith survive? But by the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th, there emerges a man who claimed to understand the origins of religion, of all religions. Sigmund Freud. Although Freud was by no means the first thinker to try and explain the psychological origins of religion, his account is perhaps the most systematic attempt to represent faith as something fundamental to early human mental development. Well, Freud, like me, came from a Jewish background, although for obvious reasons he was much more explicitly aware of it than I am. Even so, Freud never really identified himself with the religion itself. And as a student of science, he became increasingly suspicious of religion as a whole. And with the development of what became psychoanalytic theory, he began to recognize that the belief in God, that's to say in some sort of supernatural agency to which human beings were answerable, was the inevitable result of the infant's helplessness and his relationship to the apparently all-powerful figure of the father. Look, this is what he says about it in his book called The Future of an Illusion.
The rest of our inquiry is made easier because this God-creator is openly called Father. The psychoanalysis of individual human beings teaches us that the God of each of them is nothing other than an exalted father.
So he saw religion as an illusion. Now, although he describes this as a wish fulfillment, it's quite difficult to see it entirely in that light, since the figure created by the infant imagination had punitive as well as benevolent characteristics. But however Freud explained that apparent contradiction, it's quite clear that he saw religion as false and profoundly unhelpful.
Religious teachings are neurotic relics, and the time has probably come for replacing them with the results of the rational operation of the intellect.
For obvious reasons, Freud's theory disconcerted the conventionally religious. But the social implications of his theory were trivial in comparison with the politically programmatic atheism that emerged in the most radical of the ideologies that had been developing over the 100 years since Tom Paine.
Religious distress is at the same time the expression of real distress. Religion is the sigh of the oppressed creature, the heart of a heartless world, just as it is the spirit of a spiritless situation. It is the opium of the people. The demand to give up the illusion is the demand to give up a condition which needs illusions.
Now, whatever
Freud thought about the infantile origins of the illusion, for the Russian communists who had been influenced by the dialectical materialism of Karl Marx, it was an article of faith that the opium of religion would have no place in the forthcoming political millennium. They were determined to establish an illusion-free zone. And in Soviet Russia, indeed, they established what was, to all intents and purposes, the first fundamentally atheist state. The paradox is that a revolution which was designed to usher in a new golden era for humanity, tormented, tortured, imprisoned, and annihilated even more victims than Christianity at its most excessive. So it's hardly surprising that atheism has been indelibly, if unjustly, stained by its association.
By the end of the 20th century, disbelief had become much more widespread than ever. And although it's not the whole story, there's no doubt that some of the appalling social catastrophes of the last 100 years have seriously undermined faith in a benevolent God. Of course, cruelty and misfortune have always been cited as reasons for doubt. But the inescapable publicity which these excesses now receive in the mass media represent an unprecedented problem for the pious. In fact, as we enter the 21st century, for many people, the questions of belief and disbelief seem scarcely worth considering. This brings me back to the very first person I talked to in this series, the English philosopher in New York, Colin McGinn.
Nobody spends their time trying to prove to others that the Greek gods don't exist. You know, you just decide that they don't, and that's the end of the story for you. So I like to distinguish atheism from anti-theism. Anti-theism is opposition to theism. I am an anti-theist because I believe that religion is harmful. I'm not just an atheist who suddenly, my only values are that I don't agree with it. I'm actively opposed to it. But then I distinguish that from what I call post-theism or post-atheism, which is the healthy state of mind, where you've put all that behind you. Now, we can't do that yet, because there's lots of religion in the world and lots of bad results of it. But to me, the ideal society would be one in which the question of religion didn't really arise for people, or if it did, it wasn't a heavy question for them. They would say to each other, you know, those humans used to believe back there in 2003, some of them believed there was this God and he did this, others didn't, and they did TV programs about why they didn't. What a funny debate that was, you know. So it would be a post-theist society where it wasn't an issue.
To imagine what the world would be like without religion. For the simple reason that, in one form or another, it's been with us for so long. And although the number of disbelievers is now larger than anyone could have imagined as little as 100 years ago, religion still permeates social life. And in some parts of the world, it's more consolidated and oppressive than ever. So that for those like myself, and there are literally millions of us for whom there is no religion, we still live in a world in which it's difficult to be unaware of its existence. For obvious reasons, it's some of the more fanatical developments which get me most worked up. The wilder excesses of Christian creationism, and of course the suicidal and sometimes the homicidal violence to be found in some parts of the Muslim world. But I'm also rattled by some of the more complacent assumptions, which I find amongst my friends and acquaintances, that my godlessness implies some sort of lack of seriousness on my part, that people like me have failed to recognize the existence of the soul, and above all, of its immortality. Well, to be quite frank, I find this somewhat impudent. The fact that I entertain no prospects whatever of some sort of subsequent existence doesn't mean that I'm indifferent to the fact that I, like everyone else, must die. As I get older, I become more closely, if vicariously, acquainted with death and disease. In fact, as time goes by, I find myself opening the obituary pages of the newspapers with increasing apprehension. But all the same, I don't find myself wondering where these departed friends, relatives, or colleagues now are. Because as far as I'm concerned, they're nowhere. They have simply, or perhaps not quite so simply, ceased to be. So how about my own death, my own ceasing to be? Well, naturally I think about it because I'm much nearer to it now than I was. I think about how it will be. Would it be painful, for example? But still, I don't think about it in terms of will I, after all I've committed myself to, be shown to be a fool by waking up somewhere else and finding that there is something after all? And will my face be red? The thought of death is constantly there. I know that it's unlikely now that I'll see my grandchildren get married, or that I'll even see or know my great-grandchildren. In other words, I have to loosen my hold over the future. What's more, I may be in a situation where death can't come too quickly because I'll be in pain, distressed, weak, and disabled. I want to be able to reach for the bell and say, this is where I get off. I don't find it difficult to imagine not existing. I don't think about it at all, really. What I am frightened of is perhaps that near death there might be certain experiences associated with it which are painful and frightening and from which one cannot escape for the moment. It's not the fear of death, but of the mental states that sometimes exist when things are falling to bits. I'm not looking forward to that. But I am encouraged by the fact that there are perfectly ordinary people who confront their forthcoming extinction with graceful equanimity, without having to fall back on unintelligible hopes for a future state. When I visited Gloria at St. Christopher's Hospice in London, she was quite happy to talk about her lack of faith. She only asked that we did not show her face, from which I alone could see that she approached her death with unexpected calm. Were you religious as a girl?
I suppose I did, you know, Sunday school and the regular so-and-so, you know, sort of looking at choir boys and...
That's not religion, dear, that's flirty. But do you think that when you die that you will continue to exist?
No. How can I explain?
But you don't foresee that you, Gloria, will somehow continue to exist?
No.
Do you regret that?
No, because I have something... I have something else. I want to come alive. I want to be alive again, even if it's for that bare second.
But not alive again after death?
No.
You mean alive just at that moment of death?
Yes.
What would that sudden terminal aliveness consist of? Would you be a young girl again, briefly, shortly, in that?
Oh, yes. I would be young again, but I would be all the things I wanted to be, and in that sudden brief moment I'd come to, and that's all there is to it.
And then it would be over.
Yeah.
So you're looking for a sort of ecstasy at the moment of death.
Yes. Yes. I'm looking for it, but I don't know whether I shall find it.
You're a very nice, brave lady. I think it's wonderful.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed.
Okay.
Thank you. It's very, very good talking to you.
Thank
it really
you
is.
Very.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I hope the ecstasy comes and is really good.
Oh, so do I.
In spite of what the pious still prefer to believe, there is now an impressively large number of people prepared to contemplate their own mortality without the invisible means of support previously supplied by religion. And of course, to some extent, we all owe that to the pioneering efforts of the early Greek philosophers, not to mention to the often embattled thinkers of the Renaissance and the Enlightenment, and even to the social and political radicals of the last 100 years. Even if we don't explicitly recognize that pedigree, many of us now live in a secular world in which the various arguments for believing in a god or gods seem to have evaporated. As we've already seen, one of the most significant arguments in favor of the existence of an omniscient, omnipotent being was the apparent presence of intelligent design. But as we've also seen, Darwin's theory of evolution effectively annihilated what was perhaps the most dramatic evidence in favor of efficient intelligence and intention. What this has done, in effect, is to continue the process of painting religion into an increasingly small corner of reality. In fact, intelligence, which was once seen as the antecedent cause of all things, is in itself almost certainly a biological phenomenon. Far from being the initiator of things, we're now beginning to recognize that intelligence is a relatively late arrival in the universe. Like the limbs and organs, which until Darwin were visualized as the products of intelligent design, it's becoming increasingly likely that intelligence itself is the product of natural selection, inconceivable without the existence of a brain. Even the idea of the soul, which the faithful fondly visualize as the colonial outpost of an imperial power on high, will, I'm sure, shortly be explained as the autonomous product of local brain work. All the same, I have to admit that there is one aspect of our own mentality for which it's difficult as yet to foresee what type of explanation would even be relevant. I'm referring, of course, to consciousness. The point is that although I have no reason to believe that my consciousness is implemented by anything other than my brain, I remain convinced that there's something impenetrably mysterious about the relationship between brains and thoughts. And you can understand, therefore, why it's so hard to imagine, let alone tolerate, the idea that the death of the brain necessarily leads to the end of the personal self. And this, of course, is the trump card with which religion has consistently played.
In the end, I think there must be some extent to which belief or disbelief is a purely temperamental affair, and that for reasons which are quite hard to identify, human beings have always sorted themselves out into those who visualize the universe in material terms and those who see it animated throughout by a supernatural intelligence. For that reason, I think it's a mistake to see a straightforward relationship between the recent retreat of religious faith and the concomitant advance of scientific knowledge. After all, a relatively small minority of the increasing number of disbelievers has any acquaintance with modern science at all. And then, on the other hand, there's a significant number of extremely accomplished and knowledgeable scientists who retain a strong religious belief notwithstanding. All the same, I do suspect that the widespread, albeit patchily distributed, disbelief in the modern world has something to do with science. But perhaps it's more to do with what science has provided in the way of security, convenience, and comfort, and with the fact that although the general public is largely unacquainted with the theoretical basis of the immunities which they now so carelessly enjoy, the environment which science has created is so comfortable and so unthreatening that supernatural considerations have understandably weakened and faded. The consolations and assurances that were once provided by the church now seem strangely anachronistic and unnecessary. So where am I at the beginning of a century, the end of which I certainly won't live to see, posthumously or otherwise? As I said at the outset, I'm reluctant to use the word atheist to describe my own unshakable disbelief. And that's not because I'm ashamed, afraid, or even embarrassed, but simply because it seems so self-evidently true to me that there is no God, that giving that conviction a special title somehow dignifies what it denies. After all, we don't have a special word for people who don't believe in ghosts or witches. But on the other hand, that doesn't mean that I think it was scarcely worth bothering with a series of this length. On the contrary, there is a long history of atrocity committed in the name of religion, and an equally long history of truly heroic opposition. So in a sense, this series is, well, a tribute to those who have won for me and many others the right to stand up and be counted. But nowadays, there's another, and I think more important, reason. In various parts of the world, religion has undergone a politically dangerous form of revival. Islam has undergone a widespread, though by no means universal, mutation. And the non-Muslim West is seriously threatened for the foreseeable future by swarms of these lethal mutants. But on the other hand, there is now an uncouth cabal of short-sighted Christian fundamentalists in the White House who have established a morbid and, I think, rather unhelpful liaison with the Israeli establishment, an alliance which only exacerbates the otherwise inexplicable suicidal reaction to be seen in Islam. So, one way or another, I think it's increasingly important for those of us who don't believe to establish an eloquent and, in all probability, completely ineffectual resistance.